Hartelijk welkom. I have a very good afternoon to all the participants in the room, and welcome to this European election debate with the theme One Vote, Many Voices and Real Choices. And this afternoon is organized by the Klingendaal Institute, the University of Leiden and the Montesquieu Institute, as well as with the help of the The Hague University of Applied Sciences, the European Movement Netherlands, and the Netherlands Society of International Affairs. My name is Joop Hazenberg, EU watcher in Brussels, and I'm your moderator for this event, and we offer a lively and interactive program during the next 2 hours. Unlike most election debates here in the Netherlands, we focus on the European programs of the different political families. And this is also why we have MEPs from across the borders. And much is at stake at these elections, which are going to take place from the 22nd to the 25th of May. We have over 400 million citizens voting, being one of the biggest democratic events of the year. Only the Indians are with 815 million people bigger than the Europeans. And these elections are different because, of course, the European Union has gone through a very stormy period in the last 5 years, mainly because of the euro crisis. And a lot of sovereignty has been transferred in the meantime. So now it's the time with these elections for citizens to have their say, to have your say, and cast your vote. What kind of Europe do you want? Do you want a more open, a more social, greener, and bigger Europe, or do you want a more smaller, leaner, or a more liberal one? We'll have four confrontations on visions of Europe with in total 8 candidate European Parliament members who are almost all sitting here, representing the European People's Party, the Party of European Socialists, the Alliance of Liberals and Democrats for Europe Party, ALDE, the Greens, and the PVV, the Dutch PVV. Expect some clashes as they challenge each other on the two hot seats on themes like social, green, open, and light Europe. But first I want to give the floor to the University of Leiden, Bernard Steunenberg, Rick de Ruiter, and Casper van den Berg, who will present the results of a comparative research of the election program. And this will last for about 15 minutes, and after their presentation, we can start the debate. So please give a warm applause for the University of Leiden.
Thank you. Well, we have been introduced. This is Rick de Ruiter, and that's Casper van den Berg, and they will talk in a moment. My name is Bernard Steunenberg. I'm the a professor in European politics and coordinator of our Jean Monnet Center of Excellence at Leiden University. To prepare for this discussion, we did some research. We looked at the party manifestos, and we focused on your opinion. Ik zal hem dichter tegen mijn neus aan duwen. Dank u wel. And what's interesting is that looking at the party manifestos, I realized that two things happened over there. The first observation I have is that European politics has become very normal, with rather common issues. Actually, I thought we were looking at national parliamentary elections and not at European ones. So that was a new insight to me, and maybe this debate will at least clarify whether it is or is not. So I'm very curious what will happen. The second thing is that the party manifestos didn't provide a rather, let's say, outspoken vision on the European Union, to my surprise. And I'm talking about, let's say, the party manifestos of all the parties, not only of one. So there were discussions on a greener European Union or the internal market or not having an internal market, but it's not so clear where Europe is heading. So what are we going to do? So I'm very curious about the last part of the debate about the directions of European integration, Europe Alliance. How democratic should we be? What's going to happen? Are we going to have more, less, or a different Europe? So, in that respect, the manifestos were not so outspoken, and I'm hoping that this debate will clarify those issues. I'll give the word now to Rick de Ruiter, who will provide you more on the party manifestos.
Okay, thank you very much, Bernard. As you can see here, there is a graph
And at the horizontal axis, you can see all kinds of issues. And on the y-axis, the vertical axis, you can see the number of references to these issues. And what we basically did was we looked at all party manifestos at the European level, so EU party manifestos of political parties in the European Parliament, and we tried to compare them. And there were a lot of things that made it very difficult to compare those manifestos. Some were one page, others were 15 pages. Some covered all issues that you can see here. And very often, political parties try to gain some ownership of a certain issue. So as you can see here, the environment was often emphasized, with the Greens emphasizing renewable energy, but some more center-right parties emphasizing the security of energy supply. And this was also something that, which was coded under the environmental label. Well, other issues that are very important here are the internal market. Very often it was emphasized. The balancing of social and economic issues as a response to the economic crisis. But the economic crisis as such, banking union, economic and monetary union, six-pack, two-pack, was not really mentioned in these programs. And what was even mentioned less, already referred to by Professor Steunenberg, was the democratic aspect. There was hardly any reference to what a vision was for Europe, what a vision is a democratic Europe. Very few parties emphasized this. So this was the result of the coding of these manifestos, but it leaves a lot of issues unanswered. And I hope that in the debate we will hear the opinions of the various candidates for the European elections.
Thank you. Yes, we didn't just look at the various party manifestos, but we also listened to you. A survey was conducted amongst all the people present in this room, and a couple of findings from that survey we would like to share with you here. There were a couple of statements. There were 11 statements in the survey. And because of time constraints, I'm just going to talk about the one that showed the biggest degree of consensus and the one that showed the least degree of consensus or the greatest degree of polarization. Well, the statement which showed the greatest consensus has to do with energy sustainability. That is really a hot issue among this group. So the statement that said the European economy should be transformed into a global champion of energy and resource efficiency based on less energy intensive technologies and renewable energies. And this was a statement that was really literally taken from one of the manifestos. But what is interesting is that energy is also a very divisive issue. So of all the statements, the largest polarization was found on the statement on nuclear energy. So nuclear energy should form a key component of the EU's long-term energy strategy, given its potential in terms of low carbon and security goals. So apparently most of us want a lower dependency on carbon energy, but at the same time, there is much dissensus on what should be the alternative. And this topic will be discussed in more detail in round one of the debate. And then we also asked you about your voting behavior in the recent local elections here in the Netherlands. So here are the results for this group in the room. D66, local parties, and GroenLinks are very popular among this crowd. The PVV and the Animal Party are least popular. But one other thing is interesting. With only 11% of the respondents reporting that they did not vote, the voter turnout among the audience here is very high, especially given the fact that we have many also foreign friends in our midst who did not have a chance to cast their vote in the local elections. And lastly, we would like to stress what is at stake this afternoon in this debate. How many of us are still making up their minds as to who to vote for in the next elections? Who has a guess? Who is still undecided? 5% said here. One other guess. 30? That comes a little bit closer. It's 24%. So there is a considerable number of votes to win this afternoon or to lose. That's what we're going to find out this afternoon. One last point, the report Rick was just talking about, in which we analyze the different manifestos, can also be found on our website. So all the background and all the details and all the methodological issues can be found there. And I'd like to give the microphone back to Joop. Have a great debate.
Thank you very much, Kasper. And thank you to the university. You have some kind of academic context for our political debate, which will happen in a minute, but not directly, because firstly we go to the audience and we do it in a very innovative way, not an app, but I hope that everyone has a smartphone or a laptop with internet connection, because we're going to not use the traditional voting systems, these little boxes, but we're going to use the internet for that. Now I have to press a button somewhere. Sorry. Projection laptop. If you go to the site voting.cf, www.voting.cf, you can come to a site. I'm not sure if it's displayed, in which you can fill out a small questionnaire. We'll do two questions in the first round and then six in the last round. The first question is just a test. It's how you got here. And the second one, which will show up in a minute, is about your voting preference. So, on voting.cf, just to test if everyone is ready, is how did you get here today? So, did you come by public transport? I did, because I came from Brussels. On foot, on bicycle, by car, or other means. We can already see it's real time. It's quite fascinating how people are voting. I'm not sure if we can see how many people have voted already. Yes. Let me just wait for a few moments. Yeah. www.voting.cf. www.voting.cf. I'll just give you a few more moments. I hope that also the internet connection is good in this area. Maybe we can go. Okay, so it's a bit of a tie. Most people came by public transport or on bicycle. Oh, no, now it's bicycle. So I think most people live in The Hague. Okay, let's go to the next question, the real question. And that's about your voting preferences. So, what party do you intend to vote for in the upcoming EP elections? If I'm not mistaken, we'll repeat the same question after the debates. So, this is going to be interesting for our 8 candidate MEPs. I have no idea. Oh, press other. So it's just a problem where there are too many parties to be on the platform. So I'm sorry. So if you do not want to vote for any of these parties, then you can vote for other. Then you don't do anything. Then you don't open your website. Yeah. Okay. If you want to vote blanco, just don't do anything and stay where you are and don't touch anything. Okay. Well, we have a bit more coming up. I see some more elections. It's also a tie. This is quite fascinating. I think this is not representative. Because the PVV has 0 votes and they can become the biggest party. Is anyone surprised by this result? Or are we all completely biased here in the cosmopolitan city of The Hague?
Actually, you should
Excuse me?
Others.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It might be a smaller party or something else, but
yeah.
Many voters in the Netherlands who are not having any intention to vote for
them. That's absolutely true. Yeah. There are a lot of people, thank you for this comment. There are a lot of people in the Netherlands who do not want to vote. The last time, I think around 39% of the people of the elected went to vote, and that was one of the lowest scores in the EU. So let's not hope that we repeat this mistake. Did anyone not vote on purpose for this simulation? We have 2-3 people undecided. Okay, let's see if that's 4. Okay, so 200. Yeah. So, the biggest parties are clearly ALDE. The ALDE group has by far the biggest, almost 190 votes. Maybe there are more than 200 people in the room. Or now we have people from outside the room logging in. We can check that probably with the IP address later on. Then the third party is the PvdA, the Party for European Socialists, and then the Greens, and then the CDA. Okay, let's try to memorize this. The technical people on the left will also memorize this and come back to this after the debate. And now we really want to start with the four debates. So, and by the way, the hashtag is, if you want to tweet, that's hashtag EP2014, which is used across Europe for these elections. So we'll have 20 minutes for each round, and we'll start with Green Europe in a moment. And I'll ask two of the MEP candidates to stand here, and the other six to sit behind the big desk. They also get a red piece of paper, and they can use it one time during the entire debate to interrupt if they want to make a comment or have a question. I think these are the main rules. So I would now like to ask to start the introductory film on Green Europe. First, I would like to ask the six MEB candidates to sit here. And I'll mention your names. Agnes Jogerius, Cora van Nieuwenhuizen, Saïd El Kadraoui, Dirk Gotink, Marcel de Graaf en Gerben-Jan Gerbrandy. And I would like to ask. And I would like to ask Bas Eickhout and Tom van den Kendelaren to put their glasses on the hot seats. And before we start the debate, we'll have a short movie, introduction movie, by Jan Zijderveld of Unilever, who will introduce the theme. So please, if the technique can start, I think I have to do this. Okay. Jan Zijderveld of Unilever.
Hello. Thanks for the opportunity for me to say a few words to open the debate on Green Europe. I think it's always nice to start off with just remembering a few things about Europe. Europe is the biggest economic bloc in the world, the biggest economy still in the world. Secondly, it's the biggest collection of rich people in the world. I would also argue it's the biggest collection of most educated people in the world, and also the most creative people in the world. And I think, finally, it's a group of countries that has a superb infrastructure and great governance. And if you were coming from the moon and say, where were you going to live? I would probably still choose Europe, despite all our problems. So it's always good to start a debate to recognize where we are, and that's not a bad place. However, we face, I think, two really important problems. One, our economy in Europe is stalled. It's not growing anymore. Secondly, we have a massive challenge in terms of climate change. We are eating up and using up the world's resources too fast. If everyone in the world started living as well as we Europeans do, we need 3 planets. If everyone in the world started living like Americans do, we need 5 planets. So that's not sustainable. So as leaders, or as debaters today, or as big companies like Unilever, We can either be part of the problem or decide to be part of the solution. Our citizens, or in our case, our consumers, expect us to stand up and think about a new way of getting both economic growth but also sustainable growth and face into our climate challenge. So in Unilever, we've launched the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan, which has both of these components. First and foremost, to be successful as an enterprise, we want to double our business from 40 to 80 billion, and we've already reached 50 billion. But we want to do it without using up all the world's resources. We want to reduce our total impact on the environment, our whole life cycle, from upstream where we source, to how we make, to how consumers use it. We want to start sourcing all our raw materials from sustainable sources, whether that's tomatoes, palm oils, or vanilla, or cocoa in our Magnum. And we want to improve the lives of 1 billion people around the world with our products or how they supply us. So that's a big goal. Grow the business, but do it in a more sustainable way. I think this could be an inspiration for your debate, because I think Europe can do a similar thing. Europe is part of the D world, the developed world. And the responsibility of the D world, or the developed or advanced economies, is to create the next chapter, is to create the future, is to think about new solutions. So Europe needs to help create the next chapter, which is about creating economic growth, but growth that doesn't borrow from our future generations, my children and your children and your children's children. That's why I'm so excited about this debate. That's why I'm so excited to be part of Europe, to really think about how to do this and how to find this new economic model that is growing and sustainable, so our children also have a future the way we had it. So have a great day, have a great debate, and I look forward to hear the outcome.
Well, these are very kind words, and I hope that the outcome of this debate will be as fruitful as Unilever hopes. But let's first introduce our two politicians. On my left side is Bas Eickhout from the Dutch Green Party. Bas. Mr. Eickhout, Brussels almost became Europe's green capital in 2015. Were you surprised by this?
Yes, but because we were talking about Brussels, the city, and yeah, not the policies that are being done in Brussels. And if you live in Brussels, which we do during the week, then I wouldn't call Brussels, the city, a green city. But that's another debate, I guess, because we are here more to talk about the European policies.
Okay. Mr. Van den Kendelaren from Belgium, welcome. On your website, euton.eu, this is a really cool name, you wrote an open letter to President Obama. You encouraged him to bring the First Lady to his on his next visit to Brussels. Can you a bit elaborate on that request?
Yeah, we waited very long for President Obama to come and visit Brussels. The Belgians were all excited when he arrived. All of our country was almost blocked, but we didn't care because President Obama came to Belgium. We were very much longing for it, and I think for us it always reaffirms the position that Belgium, as a very small European country, has at the very heart of Europe. People like Obama, but Putin as well, come to visit the European Union, but they always pay a visit to Belgium too, and for us that's a positive thing.
Okay, thank you. Well, let's open the debate on green politics on the next 5 years for the European Parliament and the European Commission. It's all on the agenda due to the Ukraine crisis, the shale gas revolution, the ambitious goals of EU 2030 for the climate and energy, sustainable energy. So at first, I'd like to give you the chance to pitch for about a minute about your position on a greener Europe, on a competitive Europe from your party. And I'd like to start with Mr. Eickhout from the Green Party.
Okay. Well, I think when we hear Unilever, sometimes you have the feeling that he's reading out the election manifesto of the Greens. Because for us it's very clear that the future economy worldwide, but certainly also in Europe, needs to be a resource-efficient economy. It's not a debate about whether you want it or not, but it's more the question, how fast are we going to achieve that? And that has to do with Europe. It's a very densely populated continent. It's, of course, very dependent of imports of resources. And the key aspect to really make a sustainable economy for Europe is to make sure that we are resource less dependent, we import less, we recycle more, and we make sure that we are getting rid of our fossil dependency, which is good for the environment, it's good for our wallet, and it's also making us less dependent of regimes like Putin.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's a point not only the Greens agree on. I think what we saw from, or at least what I remembered from the video, is that there are two main challenges for the European Union. There is a stalling economy on the one hand, and there is the challenge of climate change. I think it is very clear that these are the two key elements, and both are obviously interlinked with each other. I would like to draw the attention to the economic side of it, because I think everyone here in this room as well is supportive of green growth, but we can't have green growth without growth in the first place. So I think before starting to, we need to start a reflection exercise on green growth, but the growth in itself is very important at this very stage. And I think all our attention, especially in the first years to come, has to go to the economic growth of the European Union, because otherwise we don't even need to think about how we're going to make this growth green.
Mm-hmm. Youth unemployment, huge unemployment, lack of growth. So why should we pay attention to the greenness of the economy now?
Well, I must say, despite of your ages, you are a bit talking about old politics, I would say. And fortunately, that is where Unilever has made the move already, that there is no contradiction anymore between economy and ecology. That is really, that was the idea, of course, of the more conservative parties in the 20th century. But what we do know now is that if you do not make sure that economic growth and ecological ownership goes hand in hand, we have a problem on all sides. And that's also, if you look at, for example, Germany, which, as far as I know, is a pretty strong economic country in Europe, it is also the country which is leading on renewables, which is at the lead of prospects of renewable energy. They are now having more job growth in renewable energy than in many other sectors. So this is showing that what Germany is doing is grasping the opportunity of dealing with their environmental challenges, but also at the same time grasping the opportunities of economic growth, but also, and that is now important, that we have to change some of our lifestyles. I mean, our dependence of fossil fuels is so hugely dominant at this moment, and I think it's also a political role to really address that part of the topic, is to make us less dependent of fossil fuel. It can be done, economically it's wise, and environmentally it's really crucial.
We'll get to that in a minute, but can it go hand in hand, economic growth and attention for green economy, like is happening in Germany?
It can, but it's based on three key principles, in my view. Affordability, first of all. Companies need to be able to produce still at an affordable price, because otherwise we won't remain competitive. Secondly, sustainability of the energy sources. And thirdly, security of provision of energy. And I think these three elements have to be taken into account. We cannot only put our money on sustainability. We cannot only put our money on affordability. But all the three items will have to go hand in hand if we want to make these two match.
And does the European Union make the right choices in these three aspects now?
I think we can still do much better, obviously. And I think this is clearly what the next elections will be about. The question is to what extent, I think, and this is also probably what you are going to wonder, to what extent the European Union will choose for a green European Union, for more green policies. Mm. And the very difficult point will be where we'll choose, or to what extent we'll choose for a green policy.
Well, but this is really, I mean, one of your political leaders, Barroso, of the EPP group, he at a certain stage said, well, I have three children, an environmental, a social, and an economic one, and they are all three sick, but I must say now I pay most of the attention to the economic one. And that is exactly what EPP is always choosing for. No matter what all the rhetoric's about, yes, of course I love green issues, it's like world peace, we are all in favor. Until the moment when it comes to real decisions. And then what you see, the EPP group, also in the European Parliament, is always choosing only for the economic side.
Can you give a concrete example of this?
A concrete example is, well, I mean, it's in the Dutch Financial Times. It was the boss of Business Europe. And Business Europe is a kind of the umbrella organization of all businesses in Europe. Well, they pretend to represent all businesses, but they're certainly not representing Unilever if you hear them. The headline in that interview yesterday in the newspaper is a typical one. It was the greatest threat for the European economy is European climate policies. Well, that really shows you don't get it. You really are not getting the point that we have to address the threats of climate change Otherwise, we cannot even discuss economics later on. And that is exactly what the Greens are pushing for. Take these two things at the same time and deliver more than just rhetorics.
Okay. Yes, I know, but to be able to address climate change, to be able to address the challenges, we need industry for that. And I think one figure says it all, really. 80% of all investment in research and development today goes or comes from industry, as long as we don't have a strong industry in the European Union. And I'm not pleading only for industry. Obviously, I plead for both going hand in hand. But I cannot but confirm that we need industry to be able to make progress in sustainable development. And I think that's very necessary to do it today.
Yeah, but again, you are trying to frame it as if I am anti-industry. Therefore, I'm also embracing what Unilever is saying. It is very clear that if you look at the future economy, of course it's with industry. Europe should not deindustrialize. That's nonsense. But the question is, what kind of industry do we want? And there we as Greens make a very clear decision. We say we go for those industries who do know what a circular economy, recycling, being less dependent on fossil energy, these kind of decisions, that's the industry that we want in Europe. And if a company decides to just stick into fossil dependency, even go to the North Pole and get all the last drops of oil out of nature, then we say, okay, there's no room for you in Europe. And I'm talking, for example, about the Dutch company Shell. And that is very clear. If you have a decision, I will embrace Unilever and not Shell. So yes for industrialization, but it's green industrialization.
I think I can agree with you on the point of green industrialization. However, the question between us, I think, is how quick do we want to go with this? And how quickly will you, for example, enforce SMEs in Europe that are 99% of Europe, how quickly will we enforce these things on them? Because I don't think Unilever has a problem with choosing green economy. I don't think they have an issue with it. I think that the people here selling ice cream, for example, here in the street, that they have the real issue with how to turn themselves into a green business. And I think we have to be really careful that we don't commit a massacre, so to say, with small and medium enterprises that we very badly need.
Massacre. Strong words, but I must say it is very interesting that the innovation, the green innovation, is happening at the local level. It's happening at SME level. So if you really are being concerned about SMEs, then you should embrace a green economy. It's not the smallest businesses who are going against it. There's a lot of activity on green economic side all over Europe, and it's the small ones. The big problem in Brussels, and now I'm talking about the European capital, is there we mainly listen to the big business. And the big business is the seven big energy utilities, RWE, E.ON, EDF. And we're talking about the very big fossil companies like Shell and BP. Those are the ones you're defending. And I'm exactly going for the SMEs where the innovation lies. So if you are concerned about SMEs, really join the green economy, green revolution.
Okay, if we talk about SMEs, there are cowboys in the US who have made a revolution possible. Shale gas, these were not the big companies but small companies. And what do you think is good now to do with the crisis in Ukraine? Energy will be high on the agenda in the coming years. Of course, a very easy solution is to promote shale gas. Are you in favor of shale gas?
Why is that an easy one to promote?
Because it's quite easy to get it off the ground.
Did you try?
I haven't tried, but I've seen that.
Have you seen the debate in the Netherlands? Have you seen the debate in the UK? Have you seen the debate in France, all on shale gas? It is a hugely difficult debate. And why is that? Because we need a lot of chemicals, we need a lot of water, and we need a lot of room to get all the shale gas out. So the decision...
And all this is happening, I'm not debating with you, but all this is happening...
Well, it seems so.
All this is happening in America, and a lot of countries like Poland, and maybe also Germany, who are very interested in shale gas. And then, of course, the question is, will we allow shale gas in Europe? But I want to... You're a clear no, but I want
clear
to ask...
No, because it's not needed.
I want to ask Van der Kellen if it's needed and if you are in favor of shale gas.
Well, I think the position first of the European Union is that we have to do something about the energy and the dependency that we have today. We can't live at this stage without Russia, or at least not in a very sustainable manner. Our position on shale gas is very clear, straightforward and simple. If research can be done on it, and if there is something, we need to investigate it. However, using it is something different, obviously.
But so? Is that our position as the Belgian Christian Democrats?
Yes, sorry.
Because the EPP position, and that's interesting, of course, your Polish colleagues are only interested in shale gas. That's really the only solution. Yesterday, another Dutch newspaper, Tusk, your Polish colleague, Prime Minister of Poland of the EPP group, he said we need energy policies, and then the next sentence, shale gas, period. And that is exactly the fossil reflex that we see of mainly people in the EPP group always going into those fossil solutions, whereas we know with those fossil solutions, we are now import dependent. We import every year the amount of 400 billion euros of fossil fuels every year into the EU. That is the economy that I don't want. And if you think that that shale gas will deliver suddenly the energy independence, the country delivered the most of getting less dependent is are the ones who have been investing in efficiency, so using less energy, and renewables like Denmark. Those are the countries leading the game.
I see a red flag. Sorry, a red flag. I see a red paper. Ms. van Nieuwhuizen of the VVD.
Well, I think the main issue here is whether you agree on an international level playing field concerning these matters. Because I speak a lot of entrepreneurs that are very worried about the competitive power we have in Europe. In fact, we are losing competitiveness. So when you take measures as Europe on your own, then exactly what Mr. Eickhout was telling, we don't have to deindustrialize. No, it will happen by itself because you cannot compete with the rest of the world when they do not take the same measures. So how is your comment on whether we need an international level playing field or should we just move on as Europe on its own?
Well, probably you've been talking to Shell and Tata Steel and these kind of companies talking about competitive power.
All kinds of entrepreneurs, small, big.
So, and secondly, well, I don't hear it a lot of SMEs, for example. And what is very important is if you now look at what we are doing with climate change, we are taking into consideration to a large extent the concerns of competitiveness. If you look at, for example, something like emission trading, we give away for free all those allowances for those big players. So what we see happening is that a lot of big players are always pretending to be concerned, but forget to tell that they got all the emission allowances for free until now. So if that's probably the next question
but
you should
you
ask.
But you also see what's happening in China and in the rest of the world.
What I say.
It's more pollutive than we have had here for well, not centuries, but for decades.
No, but so that means that we should go in the same direction. Interestingly enough, mentioning China, it's the number one investor in solar. It's the number one investor in wind energy. Mm-hmm. So if you now see how China is moving ahead on green innovation, they are outpacing Europe, and that should be our concern.
So we can agree that if we do exactly the same as China, you will be happy?
I would say, what I say is that Europe is not deciding anything because of these kind of arguments. They're not choosing for any side, mm-hmm. which means that Europe indeed at this moment is just at the standstill. Now we can do two things. Remain on that standstill and lose our competitive advantage on all fronts, mm-hmm. or go for that competitive advantage which we now have, which is innovation. On innovation, we have a competitive advantage. Labor prices are more expensive
in Europe.
No
innovation without production.
Van der Kendelaar,
I frankly don't believe we're on a standstill point in the European Union. What I believe is that we need to keep open all avenues to be able to make sure that we have energy enough to be able to compete with China, with the United States, because that's our only way to survive as an economy. Now, secondly, on the Polish newspaper you read very well, apparently, yesterday, I think it's very much up to every single member state. As long as there is no common energy policy, unfortunately, it's up to every member state to choose what kind of priorities they will put. I'm sure that in a minute we'll be discussing nuclear energy, and there as well, we have made clear choices. We have an open mind about these things, and we want to keep them open as long as it's beneficial to all of us. Because I think we have to keep an open mind on this.
Okay. If you say on energy that you're pretending as if I'm saying that I don't want an energy.
I'm not pretending anything.
If you see is that the fastest increase of energy, which resource in Europe has the fastest increase over the last couple of years? It's renewables. Renewables in Europe are increasing 5% every year. There's nothing on nuclear. I mean, France and Finland are trying to build it, but it's being prolonged and getting more expensive by the day. There's no shale gas in Europe yet. So all these options are not there. We are expanding on renewables. That's where we have the lead on innovation. And what I say is, keep that lead, promote it, stimulate it, make it faster, and start not all kind of other discussions which are
only distractions. I have to round up this, this debate, but this is also about renewables. My last question, in the EU 2030 plan that says that for Europe as a whole, we should have a target for renewables as a percentage. Should this be on a country basis or on an EU basis? For instance, in the Netherlands, we're lagging far behind. Do you want a national basis, a national target, or do you want a European target?
Very clearly a national target, because without national targets, for example, we wouldn't have had our energy accord, which was done last year in the Netherlands. We are now at 4.5%. We need to go to 14%, and only because there was that European national target, Netherlands is now finally moving on renewables. Otherwise, we would have never done that. So I'm absolutely for national targets.
Okay, thank you.
I think we keep, as the European Union, we need to keep our environmentally leadership position as the EU in the rest of the world. And I think there as well, national targets can help in achieving that those targets. And I think that's important to have national targets.
Thank you very much, Tom van den Kendelare and Bas Eickhout, for this first round. And now I would like to call for Agnes Jongerius of the Party for European Socialists and Corrie van Nieuwenhuizen of the VVD, the ALDE group, Liberals.
Yeah, zeker. Dan is even lekker voor zitten.
And we're going to discuss social Europe. You can have some water below the desk. Yeah, it's all there. And but first we need some introduction. Agnes, Mr. Jongerius. My sources tell me that you will open an office in Utrecht if you get elected. What would this office serve for?
No, I think what's happening in the, for instance, the UK, where people are having close contacts with their own MEP, I thought, why not in my own city open an office and ask people to come around if they have any questions or remarks. Okay. So
you already found an office or a place?
And I'm looking for it, but we still have some time until the 22nd of May.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Cor van Nieuwhuizen, you're a member of the VVD, and in the past you worked on issues like the OV chip card. But do you know the name of the system in Brussels? Do you know the name of the system in Brussels?
Or the OV chip card? No, yeah. I'm sorry, I don't know that.
It's called MOBIP, and it's a part of MEVB and STIP, and you can also use it for the line.
Okay, very
but
interesting.
Remember MOBIP. It's quite handy, in fact. Okay, we're going to discuss social Europe, and you already had a bit of a clash, I think, last week or 2 weeks ago, on social policies and, of course, the whole crisis, the employment crisis, and the need for growth. Also, the rising inequality in Europe in the last 5 years. Again, I'll give you the floor first for Ms. Jongerius on the question how to make Europe more social, and if it's on a national level, sorry, or of a European level.
I think this one is a very clear one, because yes, of course, we need a more social Europe. In the past 5 years, a lot of attention had to be given to banks and to budget deficits. But now we have a real employment crisis at hand, with 27 million people out of jobs. I think this will be our first priority in the next period ahead. So my party is pleading for a norm around unemployment, saying why not, next to a norm for budget deficit, also introduce a norm for unemployment, because it cannot be that in the next period member states only focus on reducing their budget deficit and just forgetting about the employment of their own people. So it's on jobs. It's on jobs on the first place, on the second place, but also as the third priority. And I think that would be also a way of tackling the inequalities which has risen in Europe. So getting jobs there stimulates member states to make their own plans for reducing their unemployment, but also being very attentive to fair jobs, just fair labor agreements, and for stopping those people being exploited.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Geris. Mr. Nieuwhuizen, a more social Europe in the next 5 years, how are you going to achieve that?
Well, let me start positive with the one thing we agree on. Of course, we have to fight unemployment. I think we all here agree that we would like unemployment to be as low as possible, as close to zero would be very ideal. But the proposal Ms. Jongerius is announcing, is that a solution? I don't think so. You can write down, okay, we want 5%, you want maybe 3, 4, 2, another percentage. By writing it down, nothing changes. Companies create jobs and not governments, and certainly not plans. So what you in fact are doing when you put on a norm, you're giving false hope for people in the southern of Europe, southern European countries, where of course we haven't had unemployment figures around 5% in the last decades. I think most countries have very high unemployment figures that, look at Spain, look at Greece, it's more about 25%, and if you look at youth unemployment, it's even around 50%. So it's not realistic, and the only way you could get close to that norm of 5% is by creating heavily subsidized jobs. Well, then it's only a matter of time before we really get to a transfer union. It would cost billions and billions to give all those millions, the 27 millions Ms. Jongerius is talking about, to give them a created job. So I think it's unwise, it's unrealistic, and it's not the solution. You have to take care that the companies can really create new jobs, and that's the way to proceed, and not by, well, putting some nice figure down. I think we all would like it to be true, but it's not the solution for the problems.
So no top-down policies for this problem. False hope, subsidized jobs, how would you respond to that?
No, I think it's quite clear that, of course, a norm is just a norm. But that's also true around the norm of around the budget deficit. You write down 3% and then indeed you stimulate the member states to work with their economic policies on lowering the budget deficit. What we have seen in the past period is that with all the attention on the budget deficits, member states, but also like the ECB, the Troika, they have forgotten the social consequences. And what we say now is that you need a really balanced, sound social economic policy where you ask member states to look at those two figures at the same time and not have your policies creating big social consequences, social unrest also, but social consequences for people losing their jobs. And of course, I know the story that the companies are creating jobs. I've worked for the trade union movement long enough to know how this is working. But on the other hand, the social policies of a country can really make a sound or not sound environment for creating jobs. If people are losing trust in the economy, like for instance you see in the Netherlands, if people are losing trust, people refuse to spend money, and then of course the trust of companies, the trust of citizens in the projects also leads to problems in your economic and your economic outcomes, also in the economic outcome considering employment.
Trust.
Well, I'd like to react on the comparison with the 3% of the budget norm. I think that was very necessary to work with that norm, because a lot of countries were spending much too much for too long, and that's why they got into trouble in the first place. That's why in those countries unemployment rates are very much higher than in our country, for example. And do you really think that, for example, our own Minister Usher here in the Netherlands needs a norm of 5%, that otherwise he wouldn't be trying his utmost, his best to downsize unemployment? Of course, every country wants unemployment to be as low as possible. But the solution is not spending more money by creating more subsidized jobs. Because you see what happens then. If you would like to promote those countries to spend more, well, I think that's not comparable with the 3%. I think that has been very, very needed. And I think we should continue on that path.
What's the solution of your party, the VVD? What do they propose to bring down unemployment in the EU? Is it the way of austerity?
Yes, I think we are on the right track with that.
We're on the right
track. Of course, what we had in the first discussion, what most important is the level playing field for our companies on an international level.
What does that mean, level playing field?
Well, that's you. How can you explain that in the shortest way? You are working under the same conditions, whether it's in the Netherlands or whether it's in Greece or in the UK or, for example, China, that you can sell your products fair and square all over the world and, for a start, in Europe on our own market. But if you the treaties we are working on with China and with the United States, I think that's you, then you have the power of over 500 million consumers versus China versus the other powers. I think that's the main solution.
So austerity and level playing field, that's the way forward.
It's indeed the way forward, but not in the direction I want to go, because it was the way forward leading to unemployment rates we see at this moment in Europe and to the rate of inequality in Europe. So I think I really don't see why people should not be in favor of challenging governance, not only on this budget deficit, because of course I do agree you should not have an unpaid bill shoven forward forever. But
so
you
how
can
will
also
we pay for 27 million jobs?
No, but you also cannot afford to let 27 million people pay the price. It's not fair for the children, but that's also not fair for people not being able to take part of the labor market. And I think, of course, you could do something in redirecting existing funds. Huh? I think you and I do agree that we would have liked more funds for innovation and research and development.
Yes, that's one thing we agree on.
I have,
but that's not an answer to the question.
Well, I have a red card again from the panel. So I'd like to give the floor to Dirk Groting of the European People's Party.
Thanks, Joe. I think it's a very interesting discussion. And Ms. Jonge is right about the social crisis that is going on in the south of Europe. But the answer is very dangerous. Young people are paying the price of past decisions that were wrong, policies that were wrong, reforms that were never made by their governments, whether left or right. The problem is that they are still responsible for those policies. in Greece, in Italy, in France, not to mention, the labor markets have to be reformed to give young people opportunities again. And as long as unions, who represent less and less of the population, stop these reforms every time that there is a proposal, especially in France, they will block the future of Europe if we don't start changing our policies. And not, it's not in, we shouldn't give Brussels the responsibility for this. We are responsible. Here, behind us.
I'm not pleading to give Europe the responsibility. I just say, just as we have this 3% norm for the budget deficit, challenge the member states putting at the table plans to reduce their unemployment. Because if we don't, I think the whole project is going to shatter anyway. You cannot go forward with indeed half of the young people in Spain being out of job.
But they want to be, we need credible politicians, because your party also supported the 3% norm a couple of years ago in the European Parliament and also here in the Dutch Parliament, and now coming with this proposal, sort of creating this alternative to the budget, necessary budget cuts, is for many people, we cannot understand
sorry,
anymore.
But then I think either I'm not very clear or you're not listening very good. I'm not saying do away the 3%. This is not my plea, but I think...
But you cannot have both.
Yeah, of course we can have both.
And who's going to pay
of
for that?
Of course we need to have both. And perhaps Mr. Eickhout is also going to say the third child of Mr. Barroso should also be at the table. But if you have your policy only focused at one target, then people are going to pay the price, and I think they're not willing to do so anymore. Also not in the Netherlands.
But you cannot seriously mean that leaders of political parties in all of the European countries need your norm to try to get unemployment down. Of course they are trying their best. But it's not a solution. Come on, you cannot mean that. For your own minister, Asscher, we are not close to 5% unemployment. Does he need your norm to do his job properly? I don't think so. I hope you don't agree with that.
No, I think it's helpful also for the Dutch debates to just challenge the proposals at the table around reduction of the unemployment. And I think social policy should be a national affair. But we can also take notice of good examples in other countries, like for instance the system they have in Austria where at the workplace...
Where they have no minimum wage, is that what you would like?
No, but... In Austria, they do have a minimum wage.
Not for my information.
They do. And in Germany, they're going to get one, thanks to our social democratic friends. But they have a system where old people at the workplace introduce new people. And of course, that's something we could also look at in the Netherlands.
We are still paying for our VUT-regeling.
Okay, maybe this gets a bit technical, but I have to, I have to close the debate quite soon. I want to ask you very briefly, one solution to the youth unemployment is labor migration. There are 2 million or even 3 million unfulfilled vacancies in the EU. But one big hindrance is the portability of social rights and pensions. Are you in favor of increasing the portability of social rights, or do you think this would stick? It would make the welfare state more European?
Well, that's a difficult question, but I think I cannot explain why someone that has worked for 10 years in Poland and for 1 year in the Netherlands should, when becoming unemployed, get paid for 11 years of work on a Dutch level. I think that's a thing that we won't agree on, so we have to find a solution like we have in our own pension system here in the Netherlands, that what you have built with one employer, you can take it with you to the other, but not told you the first example, because then people will not want to pay
and
for that.
And the Party for European Socialists, are they in favor of such portability?
I think the biggest problem around labor migration is not having fair treatment of people at the workplace. So we are pleading for equal pay for equal jobs. Portability, there has been made some progress, even in the last round in Strasbourg.
But I do think you want more? That's my question.
I don't think that will be the first thing I'm going to work on.
Okay. Thank you very much, Agnes Jurrius and Cor van Nieuwhuizen, for this debate. Thank you. And now we go to round three, open Europe, labor or external trade as well as immigration policies. And on my left is Seyed El Khadraoui from Belgium, welcome. And Dirk Goting from the Christian Democrats European People's Party, Brussels. I'm getting really confused now with Brussels, Belgium, and everything. But first, again, I start on the left. Mr. El Khadraoui, you are next to being an MEP. You're already in the member. You're already in the European Parliament. You're also a council member in Leuven. And is that beautiful city the most Dutch-style city in Belgium?
Is it?
No, it's a question.
I don't know. I mean, it's a very nice...
It looks very organized.
It's very organized, very nice city. I would like to invite you to come over and to visit us more often. And there are some Dutch students, obviously, as Erasmus exchange students. So, I don't know if it's the most Dutch city. I would assume that it's more Antwerp. But anyway.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Goting, I just came back from the Pyrenees, and apparently that's also your favorite spot in Europe to go on holiday. What is the best walk and the most stunning area of the Pyrenees?
My wife is French, and she takes me there quite nearly every year. And you have a whole system of JR routes, the Grand Route, that are absolutely fantastic. And yes, the Pyrenees are lovely. Yeah.
Okay, but you don't have a particular spot.
No, I couldn't. Depending on which side you go, you have spectacular views and a great experience. So,
okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. After this introduction, what I said, we're going to talk about open Europe, so about the integration in the world economy, and also about asylum policies. Again with Mr. Akadoui, we can start with your pitch and then Mr. Goting.
Well, obviously it's an item you can look at it from different angles. Open Europe means, for me, in the first place, are we open-minded? Are we able to continue to build on the completion of the single market to create jobs, to create growth? I think we should do it. The problem is that when you look at the results of many elections, we know that many people fear migration, fear problems that come with it, etc. So I would say we need to continue to build on Europe. There are a lot of opportunities, but at the same time we need to find answers to the fears of many people. And I think and we can make a distinction between intra-European migration, because you know that actually only 14 million people, Europeans, live or study or get their retirement in another EU country. It's only 2.8%. And we can speak about migration from the outside. I think people fear both. But all migration within Europe, I think, and then we can come back to the former debate on social issues. We need to find a solution also to social dumping, for example. We need to find a solution on how to create jobs, how to give hope to young people to build a future. And as far as the outside world is concerned, I think we need to be more optimistic. I think we have in the European Union the talent, the experience, we have the industry and the people that is able that we enable us to compete with the outside world without any problem. We can go into more details if you want on the trade agreement with the US, on how to deal with China or Russia, but that's maybe for later on.
For later. Okay, thank you. Mr. Gotting.
Yeah, a very clear introduction. And you talked about giving or protecting people because many people are worried, and that's true, but you also talked about young people and maybe the fears they have. And my fear is that we'll be stuck in 1% economic growth for the next 10 years, and we have all these debts to pay that we cannot pay. We have huge increases in public costs that is still unclear on how we are going to pay for that. So Open Europe, for me, is giving opportunities for young people and not necessarily protectionism. Secondly, yes, there are sectors that are under huge pressure, and especially older people are put under pressure on the labor market, and we need to deal with that. But also there, not only do we have loopholes in the European legislation, there's a national responsibility. And the national responsibility to protect your people on the labor market is not something you can organize in Brussels. Belgium has a great plan against what you call domicilieringsfraude. That's
okay, try to the first level.
That's no, because a huge problem in the legislation is that you can go to another, yes, you can go to another country, but you need to be able to support yourself. You need to have the means to support yourself for 1 year. And if you don't control that, if you don't check that, then obviously you're not going to solve a problem for the people that are trying to do a fair job on the labor market. And in the Netherlands especially, they should take a bit more example of the Belgians. Where you know that, Joop, when you go to the commune, they ask for your labor contract, they ask for your rental contract, and a police officer will come by at the door to check if you actually live there.
I haven't registered yet, but don't tell anyone.
You haven't registered?
I will tell them.
Anyways. But that is for me, give young people opportunities in an open Europe. We will need trade. International trade is essential. We will need innovation, and we'll need to fill some holes in European legislation. But please do not look at Brussels as if it will solve all people's problems here.
No, but you were referring to the debt problems of many member states, and I take that as a big issue. However, we ought to forget that we all together invested 1,600 billion euros to save the banks. And actually, it's the ordinary people who pay the bill. And that's not fair. So I would say we need to create also a more fair Europe. And I know that people say there is no money to invest in the economy, not from the government side. But let me tell you this. Last year, the Social Democrats published a study, and it appeared that all public authorities, all together, from local up to European level, every year miss 1,000 billion of euros of revenues due to tax fraud and tax evasion within the European Union. I'm not saying that we can take all of this money back to the authorities to invest it somehow, maybe in social issues, in revigorating the economy, etc. But if we succeed in cooperating much more with each other to reduce this amount with a few hundreds of billions or tens of billions, at least we will have some extra revenues that can be redistributed and invested in the economy to create employment and create jobs. So that's part of the answer. And I do not agree with you that it's not a European issue. I just want to come back to what Agnes said earlier on. Yes, we keep supporting the budgetary targets. But I do agree with her when she said that we also need mandatory binding social targets. Actually, next to a liberal Olli Rehn, everybody knows him, he's the Commissioner for Economic Affairs, is looking in a very tough way at the budgetary results of the member states. We should next to this liberal Olli Rehn, we should have a social Olli Rehn, who is going to look at the results of the policies of member states regarding the reduction of unemployment, the reduction of poverty. And that's what we also need, and that's why we need a balanced approach. We need a Europe that is built on two pillars and that brings social cohesion back at the core, at the heart of European policies.
If you want to make a bridge to outside of what's happening outside the EU, I'll be very happy.
Just please, a short reaction to the word binding. The word binding is essential because binding means that we will have in the coming years, if what you want it will happen, that indeed Brussels will get the same powers on social policy as they now have in controlling our budgets. We had to change our budgetary procedure here because we decided, rightly so, to control the reforms and the proposals made by the governments. So, binding is the wrong word.
We're not saying how you reach the targets.
No, you're saying creating a social Olli Rehn means after we have transferred the sovereignty on the economic, on the monetary issues, we will also have to transfer sovereignty, the great leap forward. But you're forgetting that you will lose people in that process.
No, not if you have the results. And that's what we need.
The debate is going a bit more in the direction of an internal debate of what's happening inside the EU, but I really want to focus on outside the EU. For instance, talk about the Great Leap, the Great Transatlantic Leap, the Transatlantic Trade Initiative Partnership, the TTIP, the big trade deal with the Americans, which could set standards for trades for the decades to come. What do you think about these current negotiations? And do you think it will set the standards and secure our welfare?
Well, that will depend on the outcome. Mm-hmm. We are not a priori against a deal with the United States. It could create growth and jobs on both sides of the Atlantic. If that's the case, that's fine. But we are not Americans. We don't eat meat with hormones. We have other labor standards. We have more ambitious environmental targets, etc., etc. So it will depend on what is the result of the negotiation. If it takes care of our concerns, obviously we will support it. But we have some red lines as the Social Democrats here, and so we will not accept any deal, and we will have to wait, I think, for the end of the year, maybe next year, what will be the outcome.
Mr. Gotting, do you have the same red lines as the Social Democrats do, or do you have different red lines?
We have red lines for sure, and I'm actually people are speaking as if this deal is already struck, but if the European Parliament after the elections will accept that deal, the Americans will have to make a couple of steps exactly on the issues where Said was talking about, consumer protection, our food laws. We will not throw out our standards just because that producing cars will become easier in the Netherlands and in America. For that, the deal will have to be quite ambitious. The other aspect, if you want to talk about the bigger picture, is we're also negotiating bilaterally, both of us, the US and the EU, with China. Mm-hmm. China, in a couple of decades, will be the biggest economy in the world. They will decide the standards. Like you said, India is the biggest democracy already. They will be much more forceful in imposing standards on the rest of the world, and by making this deal now, a good deal now, we can influence globalization in the next couple of years. If we don't do this deal, that will be much more difficult.
Do you share this concern or this strategy?
Well, again, if we can achieve something that takes into account our red lines, indeed, we will be like the front runner in the deals that will be negotiated the next few years. But unfortunately, we have some very important concerns. I mentioned some of them, but we also, since the NSA scandals, we also have clearly on the agenda the issue of data and how to protect them and how to protect the privacy of people's information. This is also something that we need to take into account in this deal with the United States. So it will not be an easy task. And I will be the first one to give a big applause to those who negotiated if they achieved something that we can accept. Yep. But it will not be easy.
Yeah. Okay. Also, the bigger stage is the coming graying or aging of the population is shrinking. Europe is the only continent where the labor population will shrink in the coming decades. And I was wondering how you see that, how we can overcome this challenge, because linked to a shrinking population, labor population is less economic growth and prosperity. Is active immigration from outside the EU the solution to our upcoming, not the current, but the upcoming labor problems?
Well, it will be part of it. It will be part of it. But for me, and we are actually trying to with a blue card system, which doesn't work, because high educated Indians or Argentinians, they prefer to go to Silicon Valley or to go somewhere else rather than Europe. Because intra-Europe mobility is still very, very static. And that's where I was talking about the reforms of the labor markets. We have 800 regulated professions in Europe. And working on the mutual recognition of these qualifications, what you need to be able to become a nurse in the Netherlands or to become a nurse in Spain, that is not functioning yet, and I'm sure that there's many young people that could be doing a job somewhere else in Europe, but are not, because we haven't organized our labor markets yet.
Well, I agree. I think there is a lot of potential already in the European Union. We've been discussing the high unemployment figure just a few minutes ago. So let's first use this reservoir of talent that we have and that is unused today. People from Spain and Portugal could spend part of their life in Germany or wherever else in Europe. Actually, if you compare the internal migration in Europe with the United States, it's much, much less developed, and therefore I think we need to tackle a number of issues. In order to achieve this, obviously we need to take care of a number of very complex issues. You mentioned before how to deal with social security schemes and pensions and so on, and how to tackle social dumping. It's not such an easy thing, but it's I think it should be a number one priority regarding migration. In the long run, obviously, some parts of Europe will maybe need external migration, if I may say so. Fine, let's have the debate. It's very difficult because it needs to be in cooperation with all the other member states. Otherwise, new problems will occur because we have one open area, basically. So next to an asylum policy we already developed, we also need to have a thorough debate on migration as well.
But in your next term as an MEP, you won't have this debate. Probably it will be a bit of a longer term.
No, well, we will have this debate for sure, but the impact of our discussions will maybe be before for the longer run.
And for the next term, what we need, and especially for the labour market, is filling those legal holes in the employment and the
posting
social
of workers,
the posting of workers directives, and that is a major issue that people feel as a great threat to their security, because they're working for a fair wage and someone else is working on a Latvian wage because they work 25% of their time in Latvia, which is that is a huge problem. Mm. Secondly, or
yeah, no.
Did you want to go?
Good. Good.
The question for the next 5 years will not be huge proposals about
labor or unemployment norms of 5% or taking away the
tax. It will depend on who is going to be in charge.
No, because for all those proposals, you need to change the treaties, and for that you need at least 5 years. So if you want to focus on that, you do that. But we want to focus on the things that we can do now, yeah. The reforms we can focus on now in the member states, and where Brussels can do more and needs to do more, and where Brussels can say, okay, let's focus on the priorities and not communicate about obesity in Europe.
Yes, but if I may just answer this, I mean, you are from the EPP, Mr. Barroso, when he was supported by a majority in the parliament, he announced that he would revise the posting of workers directive. He didn't do it. I mean, we need now somebody else to do what he said, and this was a really good example, but there are many other issues we really can
tackle. Called Jean-Claude Juncker.
No. Is Martin Schulz, for example. Anyway, what I want to say is that many things can be done within the current framework. It's no problem, much more than we can do today, than we do today. So,
I think, looking at this debate, I see a grand coalition coming up in the next mandate.
I'm not for a grand coalition. I don't know what you think about that, but
You should be very much against
it. If we do a grand coalition in 5 years, the extremes will be even bigger than they are now.
But you know, in the European Parliament, there is no fixed coalition at all. Yeah. And that's the good thing. We always need to fight for our values and for our ideas, and to make to build up coalitions in a case-by-case basis. And this will happen again the next few years.
Okay, thank you very much. And now we go to the extremes. Thank you. Okay, in this last round, I would like for on Europe Light, more or less Europe, I would like to... This is very nanny. I would like to give the floor to Gerbion Gerbondri of the ALDE party and Mr. De Graaf of the PVV. Welcome, gentlemen. The last round. Europe Light. Mr. De Graaf, in a recent workshop at the university, you called Machiavelli a loser. And maybe you can explain what you meant with that remark. I also recommend a book by Rinus van Schendelen called Machiavelli in Brussels, which is about lobbying in the EU.
Oh, you refer to a workshop, which is actually quite, I think, a year ago or something. The original title, you remember it, me at that, was Machiavelli is a loser and Marx is dead.
Oh yeah, that was the second part.
Well, to start with the last, Marx is dead, and we know that.
It's a factual.
As is Machiavelli, by the way, for even a longer time. Marx is dead because his ideals turned out to be, air balloons exploding with the explosion of the Soviet Russia. So we found there that, and Francis Fukuyama said that the ideology clash ended. So that was one of my statements there. And then I introduced also Machiavelli, which is a very cynical man, telling us that you should use religion for your political purposes. And at that time, as now is also the case, is still the case, religion is becoming more and more important in the political debate. So his original ideas of using religion to manipulate people now actually turns against the politicians, where specifically Islamic, the Islamic religion, we see it as an ideology, as every religion has its ideological aspects, is actually turning it into a state in a state. We see that in London, for instance, where there are Sharia neighborhoods. So religion is more important than ever And that was the background of that.
I see it, okay. Well, when you get to Brussels, when you get elected in the European Parliament, you will see one religion being very active there, that's federalism.
We'll come to that later on.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Gerondi, just as Mr. Eckhout, you've been an MEP for the last 5 years. And if you get re-elected, what would you like to change in the city of Brussels itself? And will you lobby for a high-speed train to Amsterdam? An affordable high-speed train to Amsterdam.
Well, yes, the train issue is a rather striking one. It once took me 3.5 hours to come by train from Brussels all the way back to The Hague, which I think in the 21st century is really outrageous. But that is one thing. What I like to change in the city of Brussels, I'd love to clean up the city, and especially the air. It's one of the dirtiest cities in Europe. It's an automobile city. Everything is created for using a car. I use my bicycle when I'm in Brussels, and that means that there are no traffic rules. The only rule is that no car will notice you. So if you're aware of that rule, you'll survive. And all those people that are cycling around with helmets or lightning jackets or whatsoever, it's useless. Just take my rule. That will save your life.
Very clear. But you don't have a helmet. You're not wearing a helmet when you're in Brussels.
Hey, I'm Dutch.
Okay, yeah. Okay, it's time for the pitch, and I'm going to start on the left with Mr. De Graaf. More or less Europe or Europe Light. What's your vision on Europe? What should change in the next 5 years?
Well, let me start by saying that the European Union started as a dream. As a dream of a region which could turn into a global player. Where a region which would be the most wealthiest, prosperous region in the world. Unfortunately, that dream, and I think a lot of people here in this audience believe in that dream. They're well educated. They're speaking their languages. Probably even contain some future captains of industry or politicians in the European Parliament. Well, this dream, and you have heard it in the debate, has turned into a nightmare. A nightmare of problems that we face. It's like unemployment rates. It's the government budget deficits. It's immigration issues that we're facing. It's social disruption. So there are a lot of problems we're facing. I heard someone in the debate saying that we should address fears that are living amongst the people of European countries. And I think a lot of people are not fearing, they're facing actually problems. They're facing unemployment, they're facing big deficits. They can't afford to live in a European that we envisage. So that is one thing that we see now. And then when you ask the European Union to solve these issues, I think you've got the thing all turned upside down. A lot of these problems, not to say all of these problems, are actually caused by the European Union because of the fact that it's based on the wrong premises. It's based on an understanding of people who can be made into a union, where people who can, of Greece for instance, and of the UK and of the Netherlands, who can turn into some kind of common culture. I was speaking with the ambassador of Greece last year, and he told me that Greece suffered 200 years of oppression by the Turks, and they have made it their national culture just to evade taxes and to evade government rules. We see so I don't expect that to change in the coming decades. When we look at West Germany and East Germany uniting, there was a tax introduced to Western Germans to actually fund Eastern German projects and to make that economy more like the Western German economy. And they're still paying that. We are now almost 30 years further, three decades of taxes, of billions and billions of euros, and still the Eastern German economy is not as good, as not as by far as good as the Western one. Okay. So what we're facing is a transfer union of money going from the north of Europe to the south, and that will last for decades. So my position is just exit this European Union, because as a country, the Netherlands, was very prosperous. We traded with every country in the world, and we still can do that. And we don't need the European Union for that. We can be even wealthier and more prosperous outside than inside the European Union.
Very clear. Thank you very much. Mr. Gerberdy, what's your vision on Europe, more or less heavier or a lighter one? And then we'll get to the PVV in a minute.
Yes, well, it's slightly different than the PVVs. And but let me start with a positive note. You talked about the dream we once had with the European Union. And if you listened well to Mr. Jan Zuiderveld from Unilever, that dream has come true. He was talking about someone coming from the moon. Where would he prefer to live on this globe? And he said it's Europe, because it's most prosperous, it's most stable, it's most innovative, it's the most clean. He had only positive notions. But we have to be careful to stay on top of this Olympus. And that is a very crucial thing. But let me start with something else. And I think that is important for this debate. I believe that a core business of any politician should be to improve the quality of life of our people. That is, as far as I'm concerned, our core business. And that means solving problems or creating opportunities for people. That is our core business. And due to globalization, many of the problems, many of the issues that we're facing have become transboundary, which means that we have international problems. And I can name a lot of them: climate, energy, food security, defense, foreign policy, digital economy, banks, international business. They're all international problems that we are facing here in the Netherlands and in Europe. And it's my conviction that due to the amount of problems and issues that we're facing at international level, that we have to tackle them at international level. Whether you like it or not, that is the only way to solve them. And here in the EU, that means that we have to tackle them at the European level. And therefore, what we need in the Netherlands and in Europe is a very strong, decisive, and also a more democratic Europe. Because that is the only way to solve our problems and to improve the quality of life of our people. Well, that is my introduction.
We need more Europe.
Yeah, well, I would like to address the goal of my beloved opponent, where he says, well, the goal, actually the goal of politicians is to make the people more prosperous, happy. And when he said that, I thought, and he really utterly failed. He utterly failed in that goal. Because when you look at the population of the countries of the European Union, you see massive unemployment, people who are absolutely not happy with the way their governments are forced to implement measures that actually is making life worse instead of making life better. So I think it's an illusion to say that the European Union created this more happy population of the European Union. That's one. And the second thing is, when we then look at the ideal place to live, and would that be Europe, and you're coming from the moon? Well, obviously you're coming from the moon if you think that the European Union is the best place to live. Mm.
I have someone from the panel waving, not from the moon, but from the panel.
But shouldn't we have a debate first before the others
yes,
come in?
Yes, that's right.
Because yeah. Well, now it gets interesting. Now we
okay.
can.
Okay.
When I would be coming from the moon, I probably would prefer Hawaii or something. But well, you can also choose for Romania or Bulgaria or whatever country which is also a European Union country and where actually an average wage is 360 euros. Well, these people are coming massively to the northern countries because, and I don't blame them, because it's indeed better to work and to live here because we have more to offer. And that's what's wrong. Because I think that people who want to take, for instance, the Netherlands as an example, should create that in their own country.
Okay. Trust figures are collapsing.
Yes,
you
well,
have a point.
Let's focus on the Netherlands first, because you emphasize all the negative effects of European policy. But let's focus on the positive sides as well. 1.5 million jobs in the Netherlands are directly linked to the European Union and the internal market that we're having. We are earning 120 billion euros each year on the European Union. And then I'm only talking about the Netherlands. So if you talk about negative effects, and I do agree that some jobs might get lost, then you do not take into account the enormous amounts of positive effects. Where are you going to find these 1.5 million jobs that are now created thanks to the European Union? And there is something else that I would like to emphasize, and that is really something I do not understand from a party like the PVV. If you want to improve the quality of life of Dutch people, in your case, then you need tools to do so. And then you maybe sometimes you need local tools, sometimes at regional level, sometimes at national level, but you also need tools at European level. And there we're facing a problem. Your hate towards the European Union is so huge that you take away your own possibility to improve the quality of life of your own people. And not only that, you are finding friends, and now I'm really getting nasty because it really hurts me. You're finding friends who are homophobic, racist, and anti-Semite. And that is not something that I am thinking of, but it is something that you are creating. So maybe you can explain me, what is your vision on Europe next to just stepping out, closing the curtains, and losing 1.5 million jobs in the Netherlands and 120 billion euros each year?
Mr. De Graaf.
I'll come to your question in a moment. But let me start by saying something very positive. And the positive thing is that the Netherlands were always one of the most international countries in the world. Actually, the first multinational was created here in the Netherlands. The stock market was invented in the Netherlands. So when it comes to intercontinental trade, the Netherlands were and are still one of the countries with the biggest share. So we have a tremendous a country I'm tremendously proud of. We can do a lot of things, and we have proven that in the past, and we can do that in the future. Next question is, do we need the European Union for that? Well, let me tell you that I would like to cooperate. I would like to cooperate with every country in the world, and certainly with every country in the European Union, as we did for I think, well, since there are people living here in this small part of the world, and in the last, let's say, 500 years, we have done a lot of trade with European countries without actually being part of the European Union. So that's an illusion to think that our prosperity actually depends upon a European Union as a political union that doesn't take away the necessity to actually have trade with every country in Europe. And actually, when we will exit the European Union, still 50% of our export would go to Germany, for instance. And then you can ask, well, would it be more profitable to be outside the European Union and do that same trade, or inside? And I can tell you this, that scientific calculations show that we would have a more prosperous Netherlands. So where you are calculating that we are dependent for so many jobs and for so many wealth upon the European Union, I tell you this, we will be in cooperation with all these countries, and we will do trade, and we will import and export. But what we won't have is somebody else to tell us what to do. We had a tremendous welfare state, and it's actually being taken down by the Dutch government, which you're supporting. And then you say nasty things about we cooperating with other country, with other parties in Europe in the future. Well, that's up to you. But I can tell you this, they all are fed up with the European Union.
I'm very glad that you mentioned the Dutch Golden Age and the VOC, because of course there was no European Union in those days. But what was decisive in the success of the Netherlands in those days? It was our openness. We welcomed the Huguenots from France. We welcomed Jews from all over Europe because they were kicked out of other countries. We welcomed the Portuguese. That was the decisive thing that made Holland, the Netherlands, the Republic, to create such a golden age and to create the first multinational called the VOC. And that is exactly what you're trying to destroy in the Netherlands now. If we want a new golden age, then we have to open our windows. We have to welcome talents from all over the world into the Netherlands and not kick them out, like you're doing at the moment. So it is not only the European Union that you're blaming, you're also not, or no, let me rephrase that, you're blind for why we were so successful in the past. And you cling to certain things from the past that we will lose if we do not open our windows instead of closing them down.
I'm just going to the panel, to Mr. Agarawi, for another perspective on this debate.
Obviously, this is a very important issue, and I have to say I'm rather supporting Mr. Gerbrandy on this, as most of us, I assume. Let me say the following. The world has changed compared to the pre-colonial times. You know, the Verenigde Oost-Indische Compagnie, that would not work today as it was many centuries ago. We are now living in a globalized world where we need to cooperate with each other at the European level to protect our way of life, to have a say in how future challenges have to be dealt with. Because keep in mind that even with all Europeans all together, we are only representing 7% of world population. Thinking that a rather small country such as the Netherlands can have an influence on how the world goes in future is rather naive, and each of us will be neglected. I think that leaving the European Union, especially an important country such as the Netherlands, will have as a result at some point the disintegration of this whole project. And this will...
Maybe that's precisely what they want.
That is what you want. But this, the alternative is nationalism. Is going back to confrontation as we did in Europe during many centuries. And that is exactly what we wanted to avoid by creating the European Union.
Okay.
This being said, I just want to add one other sentence. This does not mean that everything that Europe is deciding is positive or good. We need to stay critical, and we all have here behind the table different views on how Europe should go forward. But that's a political debate. So for me, the debate should not be about being against or in favor of Europe. It's about what kind of Europe do you want, and what kind of majorities are we going to find to change the course of Europe and to take other decisions.
Mr. De Graaf, you're almost leading in the polls next to D66.
Yep.
What is the feedback you get from people who write or mail you or contact you on the EU? What are their worries?
Well, as I started this debate with, we get letters from people who are actually faced with unemployment, with violence of people who do not adapt to the Dutch ways and the Dutch values. So we got a lot of support from old people, young people, also, well, so basically that is what we get as feedback, that we should keep on the right track. Whether or not we're in an environment where, like the media, they're D66 or the Social Democrats are having the upper hand. That's true. I mean, and they're creating an image of our political views and our economic views, which are distorted as much as Mr. Gerbrandy or my dear future colleague here on the table is describing. We are not just nationalists. Yes, we are proud of the Netherlands, and yes, we want to do as much trade as possible with every country in the world. And we think we can make better trade agreements on our own. When you look at, for instance, the BRIC countries, which are the fastest growing economies in the world, and you look at how much the European Union profits from it, they're really the region that is profiting the least of these growing economies. And then when you look at the Netherlands and how they're doing. Within that perspective, within the European Union, they're at the bottom of the row. You know, they're performing worst, whereas we were the best country in the world doing trade with others. So I think, from that perspective, we are absolutely multinationalists and not nationalists. So I'm not saying we're going and to defend ourselves behind the dikes. I think that's really a caricature.
We should become independent like the Norwegians, the Swiss, the British maybe soon.
Yes, well, what irritates me most of all is that the PVV is not coming up with any solutions. And the study you are quoting from, you called it scientific. We are here on grounds of the University of Leiden, so we have to be a bit careful on what we call scientific.
It's a research consultant from London.
No, but yeah. We've all seen the comments from experts in all fields. Nobody takes this study seriously. And to be honest, if I ask them and I give them sufficient amounts of money to write a nice report that will say that if my son is forward of Ajax next year, that they will win the Champions League Cup, then I'm afraid that they are willing to come up with that same conclusion. And my son is 12 years old, so that explains how strange that is. So what irritates me most is you have no solutions for those people who did lose their job. Because you're right, some people lose their job because that is called the dynamics of the economy. It's changing. I had a debate on transport policy this week, and there was someone from the SP, the Socialist Party, and he was claiming the same. You're a bit in the same pool here. And he said that it's criminal that drivers from Romania, Bulgaria are taking over and are taking the place of Dutch lorry drivers. And then there was this guy who owned a logistics company, and he said, "This is absolutely not true, and you should not call me criminal, because what happened is that, yes, I have more drivers from Bulgaria and Romania now than from the Netherlands, but the amount of jobs in the Netherlands has increased tremendously. And not only that, we hired more Dutch people than ever before. And not only that, but the quality of their jobs has increased as well." It is a bit like the miners in the old days. They went up to the streets to protest against the closing of the mines because they were afraid of what would happen after the closure of the mines. But their lives improved, and not only their lives, but also the lives of their children and grandchildren. So please think about future generations and try to think about solutions instead of just blaming either the European Union or certain groups in our society.
I have to close the debate, the final word is for Mr. De Graaf.
You're living in a fantasy. Sorry, you're living in a fantasy, absolutely. When you really think that people in the Netherlands are now being better off because of the European Union than without it, I think you're utterly wrong. What we see is we offer a solution, and the solution is take away the cause. And the cause is the European Union. So start with that. Exit the European Union so we can stand on our own feet and we can make the Netherlands prosperous again.
Okay, thank you very much.
Do you remember how Jan-Peter Balkenende went into
Mr.
the White House?
Mr. Gimli, I'm closing the debate.
We're closed? Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Gaaf. Thank you, Mr. Cabaret. I think it's time for me to push a button again, because after these four stimulating debates, we are getting very close to the to the reception, to the drinks, which is called a cocktail networking reception in Brussels. I've never seen cocktails, but always tepid beer and tepid wine, but that's a different matter. First, we go to the voting again. And we'll have, I think, six more questions on the different issues that were debated. And we're starting again. The website is once again is where's voting? www.voting.cf. So again, you can give your opinion on this question, and we have six in total. So the maximum 5% unemployment as being promoted by the Party for European Socialists. It's quite fascinating to see it being built up in real time. I hope that people are not being influenced by the bandwagon effect, if anyone knows what it is. But there seems to be little support for this maximum of 5% unemployment. Maybe we can go to the next question. Yes, next question is, making the EU's economy greener is important, but not if our economic competitiveness is thereby undermined. Again, cast your votes. This is a bit more stronger image. It's getting too tight, I think. Oops. So the room seems to be a bit divisive on it. I'll close it in 10 seconds. Okay, let's close it. It's a mixed picture, but people either agree or disagree, but most, it's more, yeah. There's quite a lot of worry about this. Okay, next question, please. Question five. Rigorous enforcement of internal market legislation should be an absolute priority. So enforcement of international market legislation should be a priority. We're in Northern Europe, so this is not too surprising that most people agree.
Yeah, it's true.
Rules are rules. Wow. I think we're getting the picture. Closing in 10 seconds. Yes, we have a winner. Rules must be rules. Question six, please. Or five. Six on mine. If there is one thing we should have learned from the economic crisis is that we need a less integrated Europe and not more integration. I really wonder what people are... Oh dear. You're quick voters. Again, this is probably the pro-European bias in the audience. Though a lot of people seem to be neutral on this matter. Interested. This is quite interesting. This is by far the most neutral. Neutral is quite dominant in this little poll. 35 votes. All right. And then we get a repeat of the question we did first, not how did you get here by public transport, but what party do you intend to vote? And this will be very interesting. Are you going to change your vote or your intention to vote compared to before the four debates? And please don't follow the bandwagon. Did we have one vote on for the PVV before the... So if your party is not on the list, you can vote other. Sorry about that. 6 votes for PVV. That's a big win, I think.
VVD's and diesels, yeah.
Again, ALDE seems to be the biggest faction in the group. If you look at European polls, it's a bit of a race between the EPP, the Christian Democrats, and the SND, the Socialist and Democrats group. So again, PVD and D6 are by far the biggest parties. And 7 votes for the PVV. And now the final question. Which candidate MEP was the strongest debater this afternoon? Was this Bas Eickhout, Sid Agadawi, Gabriel Gerbrandier, Dirk Groting, Marcel de Graaf, Agnes Jongerius, Cor van Nieuwenhuizen, or Tom van de Kendelaren? Cast your votes, please. Closing in 10. 5 seconds. Kun je dicht doen? And let's close the poll. The winner of this debate round, the best debater of this evening, is Mr. Gerbion Gerbrandy. Congratulations. Thank you very much for attending this quite extensive debate. I would like now to ask you to invite you for drinks. I think everybody got a small consumption voucher, and the drinks are in the hall. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.